Belinda Audio and the O'Brien Press present this unabridged recording of The Harp of Power, The Book of Secrets, Book 2, written by Alex Dunne and read by Róisín Rankin. Dedication. For Richard, who cheers me on every step of the way. Prologue. From the Darkness of the Well. It was dark at the bottom of the well. So dark that Kathleen never knew whether it was night or day, and that was just how she liked it. Her world consisted of little more than damp stone walls coated with centuries of mould and slime and the snuffling sounds of mice and voles who would occasionally pass through her lair. No creature ever stayed long in the well, and that was also to her liking. After thousands of years, Kathleen simply wanted to be left alone with her memories. It had not always been this way. Once upon a time, Kathleen was a warrior and a queen. Her people were a mighty tribe known as the Formorians, and they worshipped her for her cruelty and her cunning. For many years, she led the Formorians into combat with spear in hand and her beloved husband Balor by her side. The mere sight of them on the battlefield was enough to make grown men and women tremble and weep. Together, Kathleen and Balor ruled the land with an iron fist, until one day, a new tribe landed on the rocky shores of their island kingdom. They called themselves the Tuhadidanan, the people of the goddess Danu, and they set about conquering the Formorians' land. Kathleen and Balor did not take such an insult to their rule lightly, and soon the two tribes began to clash. The Tuhadidanan were strong, but so were the Formorians, and neither tribe was able to gain the upper hand. So it remained until the fateful day the two forces met on the fields of Moytura for their final battle. It was a memory that would live on in Kathleen's mind forever, because it was the day she lost everything. Her husband, her kingdom, and her purpose. The Tuhadidanan had finally defeated the Formorians and become the rulers of the land of Ireland. Kathleen survived the Battle of Moytura and went into hiding, trying to process her grief. Through her long years of isolation, she often thought back to that day and wondered how different it might have been if only her plans had come to fruition. If the Formorians had been able to hold on to the treasure they had stolen from the Tuhadidanan. In time, her sadness turned to anger, which burned white hot inside her. Soon, her only thought was of revenge. For many years, she roamed the land from shore to shore, over mountains and through valleys, waiting for her chance to strike. But her enemies were powerful, and she was alone, a shadow of her former self. As time wore on, her flesh decayed and her bones became dust, and Kathleen found herself as little more than a spirit, trapped somewhere between life and death. But still her anger fueled her, even if there was nothing she could do but watch and wait. She would slip into the Tuhadidanan's strongholds, an unseen shadow, and do her best to learn all she could about her enemies and how they might be defeated. She became convinced that the way to defeat them lay with the very treasure that the Formorians had tried to steal away all those years ago. But Kathleen was just a spirit, and without a body, what could she do? Eventually, all things must end, even the reign of the mighty Tuhadidanan. The day came when they were forced to retreat to the other world, far away from Kathleen and her schemes. For the first time in centuries, Kathleen was truly alone, a ghost among an unfamiliar people, with all hope of vengeance gone. It was then that she found the well. Kathleen knew that wells are in between places, trapped somewhere between the other world and the mortal realm, just as she herself was, and it seemed as good a place as any to wait out the rest of eternity. For a time, her peace would occasionally be disturbed by pilgrims who believed the well to be a holy place and came in search of blessings from the water, but they had not come by for many years. Like Kethlin, the well was largely forgotten, and so she was alone in her silence. Until one day, she heard a voice. "It has to be around here somewhere. Are you sure you don't smell anything?" The sound came as a shock to Kethlin. She could not remember the last time she had heard a voice, a human voice, and so close to her.
"Nothing yet. Sorry, Becca. If it was here, I'd know. Nothing gets past these nostrils," said a second voice.
An animal voice, Kethlin noted. And yet it seemed to be speaking directly to the human. She should ignore them. What did she care for humans and their ways? But after so many years with nothing but her own regrets to keep her company, Kethlin couldn't help but be intrigued. She allowed herself to drift up the well, just a bit, so she could better hear their conversation.
"I don't get it," said the human.
Becca, she supposed.
"According to the map, the holy well should be right here."
"Pfft, map schmap," said the animal. "Come on, it's getting late and I'm starving. Let's just go and... Oh, wait a second. What do we have here?"
"Have you found it?"
The human's voice raised to an excited pitch.
"Hang on, let me just... Ew, yuck, that is definitely the smell of stinky old well water. It's right over here, Becca."
The human squealed and suddenly, Kethlin's world was ripped apart. A beam of sunlight lit up the well for a moment before it was covered up again by the face of a young woman peering down at her. Kethlin almost shrank back before remembering that this woman couldn't see her. Shame flooded through her. How far she had fallen from her days as a warrior queen.
"Well done, Vinny. You're getting an extra mouse for dinner tonight."
Becca's face disappeared from the hole and a smaller, furrier face appeared in her place. It looked to Kethlin like a pine marten, or perhaps a stoat.
"Woohoo!"
said the small creature Kethlin now knew to be called Vinny.
"Want me to start digging this up? As well as being an expert sniffer, I am, in fact, a world-class digger."
"I know you are," said Becca.
Kethlin could almost hear the smile in her voice, and it made her sick. "But let's leave it as it is for now. It's already getting dark, and I don't want to risk disturbing the magic. We have the location, so we can always come back another day and open it up properly." Becca was saying something else, but Kethlin was no longer paying attention. She had spoken of magic. Magic. Hearing the word uttered on mortal lips set her mind aflame. Could this human woman know something of the old ways? How could that be? Back in Kethlin's time, humans were pathetic creatures, made to be ruled. She moved closer now. Her spirit pressed against the opening of the well, desperate to learn more.
"So this is definitely the right well?" asked Vinny.
"I can't be sure until I get some of the water and run some tests," said Becca. "But I think so. There's something about this place. I can almost feel the air humming with old magic. Can't you?"
The stoat made a small squeak of agreement.
"But that's a job for another day," Becca continued. "Right now, I think we should head back home and get dinner started. Hop up on my shoulder."
"Now you're talking," said Vinny.
At that, Kethlin snapped to attention. She could hear the sound of whooshing grass as the woman began to trudge back through the field and away from the well. Away from her. She had only a moment to consider before Becca would be too far away for her to follow. When she took refuge in the well all those years ago, it was because she believed that when the two Hadadanan left the mortal realm, the last dregs of magic had left with them. She thought her chance at revenge was long gone, and that she would stay in this dark hole until time and memory were no more. But the appearance of this young woman complicated matters. She said she was going to come back another day,
but that could be weeks away, and now that a new world of possibility had opened up for her, Kethlyn found she could no longer wait a single second. Without a backward glance, she surged up through the mouth of the well and began to follow the young woman home. After so many years rotting in isolation, Kethlyn's mind had begun to whir back to life, and the first thing she thought of was revenge. Chapter 1. Crosses and Knot.
I don't think I'm doing it right, said Kat, throwing her half-finished St. Bridget's cross down on the coffee table in frustration. It's all weird and wonky looking.
You're weird and wonky looking, said Shane.
Oh, ha ha, and I suppose yours is perfect, is it?
She looked over at Shane, who was tying a rubber band over one arm of his own cross, which Kat noticed to her annoyance was indeed perfect looking.
It's not that hard, he said, shooting her a self-satisfied grin.
Well done, Shane, said Kat's granny, who was hovering over them, inspecting their handiwork. You must take that home with you and show your mammy and Uncle Brian.
The sound of pots and pans crashing to the ground grabbed Granny's attention, and Kat took the opportunity to mouth nerd at Shane, who stuck out his tongue in return.
What's going on in there? Granny yelled. Do I need to come in and clean up your mess?
A small bald head appeared at the living room door and looked in at them sheepishly. It had been 3 months since Kat first met the fairy known as the Cluricon, but she still felt a little thrill whenever he appeared. It reminded her that the events of Halloween night had really happened, that she had ventured into the world of dangerous and magical creatures and lived to tell the tale. Granny had always told her she had the sight, the ability to see all things supernatural, but a small part of her had always wondered whether Granny was just trying to make her feel special. When she had woken up on Halloween morning to find that her baby brother Mikey had been taken by the Pooka and the Trooping Fairies and a changeling had been left in his place, all doubts were gone. She really did have the sight. Ever since then, life hadn't been the same. It seemed as though there was magic everywhere, and Kat wanted to learn about it all.
Nothing to be worrying about, Mrs. Dunne, said the Cluricon,
sweating slightly and darting his eyes back toward the kitchen.
I've got it all under control.
All right, said Granny, with some scepticism.
But call me if you need a hand. The last thing I want is for you to be burning yourself on the hob.
Again, added Kat, under her breath.
The Cluricon gave a little bob of thanks and scurried back to the kitchen. Granny sighed.
What will I do with that fella?
Another unpleasant surprise Kat had on Halloween morning was learning that Granny was in hospital, having suffered a heart attack. She spent a full week recovering and arrived home to find the Cluricon at her door with cap in hand, looking shamefaced. Apparently, he was feeling guilty over the part he had played in Kat and Shane's Halloween adventure and refused to leave until he made amends. Since Granny wasn't back to full health, she agreed he could help out around the house until she got back on her feet. That was almost 3 months ago, but the Cluricon showed no sign of leaving. Granny pretended to be annoyed by it, but she had to admit that having an extra pair of hands around to help with the cooking and cleaning was useful. Plus, Kat knew that they ended each day by sharing a box of biscuits and catching up on that day's soaps. She thought that Granny secretly enjoyed the Cluricon's company, even if she did complain about him.
Is this any better?
She asked, holding up her latest lopsided attempt at cross-making. Granny tutted.
All right, budge over and I'll show you how it's done.
She lowered herself to the floor with a small groan and reached for a handful of reeds.
We'll do one of the three-armed crosses first. They're easier than the four-armed ones to get the hang of. Now, watch my hands.
Kat watched as Granny began to weave the reeds together, forming a perfect triangle.
How do you do that so quickly? It has to be magic, she said, only half joking.
Granny smiled and tied off each arm of the cross with a rubber band.
It's no magic, only years of practice. You'll get the hang of it soon, Katrina.
Why are they called St. Bridget's Crosses? Asked Shane, already halfway through weaving his second one, which Kat couldn't help but notice was looking even neater than the last. They don't really look like crosses, do they? More like ninja throwing stars or something. He lobbed the cross at Kat to demonstrate his point.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.